Ladies and gentlemen, the very word secrecy is repugnant in a free and open society. And we are, as a people, inherently and historically opposed to secret societies, to secret oaths, and to secret proceedings.
JFK was the last truly popular president of the United States of America. Assassination is used to adjust the outcomes of elections. Lee Harvey Oswald is innocent. Lee Harvey Oswald deserves to be pardoned posthumously. And the reason for that is because there are photographs of Lee Harvey Oswald standing in the crowd watching JFK's cavalcade go by. Because of these photos, it is obvious that Lee Harvey Oswald was framed. There's no way that he could have been in the book depository, and Lee Harvey Oswald was a stand-byer. He was just in the crowd, and he watched the motorcade go by, so there's no way that he could have actually played any part whatsoever in the actual firing of the shots that killed JFK.
As President Kennedy's motorcade left the center of Dallas, where President Kennedy was shot today from an ambush.
We see Jackie Kennedy leap to the back of the car, and what she's doing, she's trying to collect and save parts of her husband's brain. The bullets came from at least two different directions, and analysis of the famous footage filmed by Mr. Zapruder actually shows the trails, the condensation trails of at least one of the bullets. And the bullets came in from two different angles, which means that there must have been a minimum of two assassins. The leader of the FBI at the time of the Kennedy assassination was J. Edgar Hoover. J. Edgar Hoover was a cross-dresser. He was a very strange man with a lot of secrets. J. Edgar Hoover was in charge of the FBI, and when you join the FBI, one of the first lessons that you learn when you investigate a crime is to ask, who benefits from that crime? Well, the person that benefited the most from the JFK assassination was Lyndon B. Johnson. Lyndon B. Johnson was sworn in very, very quickly. In actual fact, one of the witnesses was Jackie Kennedy. And Jackie Kennedy stood there as a witness, and she still had parts of her husband's brain splattered over her clothes. Lyndon B. Johnson therefore became an unelected president of the United States of America. What we saw from that moment onwards is that he stepped up US military activities, not only in Vietnam, but all over the world. That's a trend which continues to this day. Lyndon B. Johnson was a pervert. He used to ask White House security people to telephone young secretaries in the middle of the night, pretending that he had dictation. Now, we know this because there was a tape recorder installed in one of the drawers inside the presidential desk at the Oval Office, and I've got those tapes. And you can hear Lyndon B. Johnson doing most of his presidential duties on the telephone. But the reason that he preferred the telephone is because he didn't want anything written down.
I want the five smartest, best educated, fastest, prettiest secretaries in Washington. I don't want any old, broken-down old maids. I want them from 25 to 40. I want them that can work Saturday and Sunday.
Right.
I want them that can work at night, not be afraid to go home after the Secret Service takes them out of the gate. I want them to have a college degree, if it's at all possible,
mm-hmm.
and be able to keep secrets. And I've got to have some people that I can trust.
Oh, where are you?
I'm at home. Who's this?
This is the president.
Oh.
What are you doing?
Oh, I think someone's playing with me.
No, no, you know, I want to talk to you about our work, honey. Where are you, at home?
Oh, yes, I am.
Are you busy?
No, I'm not.
Can you come down here immediately?
Oh, I'd be glad to.
Come down. I've got Jack Valenti here, and we want to talk to you about a little reassignment.
Garage Blue speaking.
This is Jack Valenti speaking.
Yes, sir.
Would you send a car to pick up Miss Whittington?
Miss Whittington?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much.
All right.
Now, lots of people have seen documentaries made by a Christian chap in America called Alex Jones. And Alex has been quite courageous, and he's just literally walked into this place in Northern California. It's called Bohemian Grove, and it's a private estate, which is actually run by the Bohemian Club, which has been established for a very, very long time in San Francisco. That's where their headquarters are. And it's a bit of a strange place. They invite people like the former Prime Minister of Britain, John Major, the grey man, to give lakeside talks and speeches. And they've had, you know, former chancellors of Germany, and they have the bosses of Fortune 500 corporations giving speeches, and there's even been the odd speech by astronauts. Now, that doesn't sound too strange until you then realize that these speeches are by the side of a lake, and on the other side of the lake there is this stone, cement and metal, and I think parts of it are made out of fiberglass, statue of an owl. Now, the owl has been used as a symbol in the past by, say for example, the Bavarian Illuminati. And it's also been used by other covens and other sort of esoteric and occult groups throughout history. And when you joined the Bavarian Illuminati, you were actually put into a school with other people that had just joined. And the pupils, the new adepts, the novices, they were called Minivals. And the Bavarian Illuminati actually divided their new members into churches, and they were called the Churches of the Minivals. And their logo, or their symbol, was an owl, and that owl comes from the ancient Mediterranean, from the mystery schools that were on Crete and Cyprus and other islands in the Mediterranean. And they also used the owl symbol, and the owl has become known as the Owl of Minerva. And in actual fact, there's an entire area in the south of France, bordering the Mediterranean Sea, where there are many, many castles built by Gnostic sects like the Cathars. They were basically running their own form of a kind of Gnostic church or an occult church. And this entire area of France is called the Minervois. And the owl, which we see on the other side of the lake from where these lectures are given at Bohemian Grove, is the owl of Minerva. There is a small altar at the base of the owl, and on that altar we see an ever-burning flame, an everlasting flame. And that flame is coming from an Aladdin's lamp. And that is not Aladdin's lamp from the fairy tale. It is, in actual fact, an effigy of the brass vessel that was used by King Solomon to entrap the demons that are described in the Goetia. Now, where else do we see a cult using this Aladdin's lamp? Well, we see it at Yale University. We see it inside the headquarters of the Skull and Bones. And the Skull and Bones is a fraternity. It's a sort of pseudo-Germanic offshoot of the Bavarian Illuminati that was set up in the 1800s. And there was a break-in by a sort of fake fraternity that was set up called the Order of the File and Claw. That's a file and a crowbar. And they set up their fake fraternity just literally to break into the headquarters of the Skull and Bones. And this has happened twice. And there are actually photographs of people from the File and Claw, and in more recent times another group that actually managed to break their way through a window and get inside the headquarters of the Skull and Bones. And there again we find that the Skull and Bones also have a everlasting flame in the form of the classic Aladdin's lamp. And these are signs that we are dealing with fraternities, covens, occult groups who very, very much understand the significance of the Goetia, and they very, very much understand the power of these demons. And the fact that you've got the Aladdin's lamp being used by Skull and Bones, and the Aladdin's lamp being used by the Bohemian Club at Bohemian Grove, shows that there is a demonic aspect to what these groups are interested in. Yes, they have interesting speeches by politicians, which are, for the most part, fairly innocuous, anemic, and don't really harm anyone, but I can tell you now that there is a darker aspect, higher secrets within these groups, and they are linked to the ancient legends of King Solomon and the Goetia.
At Yale University, home to the secret society known as the Skull and Bones, which has initiated several vice presidents, senators, and presidents, there is an ancient manuscript written completely in cipher. This manuscript has never been publicly translated. It was acquired by Yale from a book trader called Wilfred Voynich, and has become known as the Voynich Manuscript. This handwritten, highly detailed manuscript was discovered by Wilfred Voynich at Villa Mondrigoni near Frascati, south of Rome, more than 100 years ago. Villa Mondrigoni means the house of the world of dragons. Villa Mondrigoni was a training college for Jesuits. The most famous Jesuit of all time was Ignatius Loyola, whose secret society was the first to use the name Illuminati. The secret discipline of the Jesuit secret societies inspired Heinrich Himmler to form his own SS, Cult of the Black Sun. Adam Weishaupt was a Jesuit, and he formed the Bavarian Illuminati secret society based on the secret teachings of Jesuits in the 1700s. Like many buildings owned by secret societies and institutions of the royal political elite, Villa Mondrigioni has a garden filled with statues of reptilian creatures. Villa Mondrigioni was recently filmed by the BBC for a documentary about the Voynich manuscript. Wilfred Voynich acquired the manuscript and took it back to his shop in Shaftesbury Avenue in central London. He placed a price tag of $165,000 on the manuscript, which was full of diagrams of herbs, flowers, and vines. It is patently clear to anyone who has studied magic that the Voynich manuscript is actually a book of magical spells, incantations, magical astrology, cosmology, and herbology. Many drawings in the Voynich manuscript feature hallucinogenic plants, such as the blue lily of the Nile, which has been confirmed by Professor Andrew Sherrett of Sheffield University as containing hallucinogenic alkaloids which create a feeling similar to modern-day ecstasy, or MDMA. The Voynich manuscript has drawings of naked women standing and laying in pools of water with tube-like structures around them. These women are more than likely oracles laying and standing in pools in underground caverns. Other diagrams in the Voynich manuscript show how to place a goat in the center of a magic circle and transform its spirit into the evil goat of Mendes, one of the ancient apparitions associated with the devil himself. Manuscript is a magical textbook with drawings of hallucinogenic plants and tube or trumpet-shaped apparatus. In spiritualism, it is very common that whispers from spirits are amplified using what is known as a spirit trumpet. At various underground oracle temples, crowds would sit around openings carved into the rock and listen to the amplified whispers of the oracle sitting deep within the temple.
I invite you to drink the healing water and ride horses through all time together. Let's not hide what we have heard, and let's keep what we have found.
The Voynich manuscript is written entirely in cipher, and there are only three manuscripts written entirely in code prior to the year 1500. The Voynich manuscript is one of them. Many words in the manuscript repeat, and this is a sure sign that the manuscript contains spells, as magical incantations often repeat the same word many times.
Peggy, get up. Repeat after me the words of the Suzama ritual. Uriel Seraphim.
Uriel Seraphim.
Io potesta.
Io potesta.
Zati Zata.
Zati Zata.
Galatim Galata.
Galatim Galata.
At the corner of each page of the Voynich manuscript, page numbers have been added, and the handwriting has been matched to that of Elizabethan magician Dr. John Dee and psychic medium Edward Kelly. The Voynich manuscript is perhaps the most important magical text of its age, dating from before the 15th century. It is now in the custody of the Beinecke Library at Yale University, who strictly forbid public access to the Voynich manuscript. When the BBC recently made a programme and radio show about the manuscript, they were prevented from removing the manuscript from the room, and the curator refused to utter even a single word. Clearly, the Voynich manuscript is a magical grimoire, part of a corpus of magical works which were codenamed the Holy Grail in the 12th and 13th centuries. According to a letter found inside the Voynich manuscript, it had previously been owned by Emperor Rudolf in Prague, who had employed Dr. John Dee and Edward Kelly to conjure spirits for the royal political elite. The British Library, the Louvre in Paris, and even the royal collection of the British royal family all have similar grimoire texts in their vaults. Most of the original grimoire texts, almost without exception, were written in Arabic and Hebrew. Before the Kabbalah became popular in 13th century Europe, there existed in ancient Israel a form of Jewish shamanic magic known as Mahaseh Merkava, the working of the chariot. Many of the grimoire texts explain the techniques for summoning demons and even how to invoke the spirits of planets into the magician's magic circle. The original texts are based on knowledge from before the time of the pharaohs. The Catholic Church formed the Inquisitions in order to control the distribution of this occult knowledge. In Umberto Eco's book, The Name of the Rose, he tells of how medieval monks poisoned each other in order to keep certain ancient texts secret.
The only left-handed member of your community is, or rather was, Brother Berenger, the assistant librarian. Now, what kind of secret knowledge would he have been privy to?
I have the feeling that you're about to tell me.
Books. Restricted books. Spiritually dangerous books.
Most of the well-known grimoires are said to have been written, or at least commissioned, by King Solomon of Israel. Under Jewish law, it is forbidden for anyone under the age of 40 years to study the Kabbalah. However, during the medieval era, a rabbi teaching Kabbalistic studies